Hi, and welcome to Azure Week. I'm Scott Wiley from Microsoft Learning Experiences, and I want to share with you a little bit about what we're going to cover this week. So we've got 5 days of Azure goodness taking you through all sorts of cool things from experts. And whether you're watching live or on demand, we're going to make sure this is a live and engaging experience for you. So, what are you going to see and learn? Today is all about overview, taking you through the broad sweep of the platform. Day two is Architecture Day, design practices, architectural guidance, all that kind of thing. You know you'll love it. Developer Day is day three. We're going to take you through a journey through the tools and the capabilities for web developers. Day four is Infrastructure Day. Learn how you can integrate your on-premises infrastructure with Windows Azure. And day five, well, that's Devices Day, and that's about the Internet of Things and how you can connect devices of all kinds to Azure. So behind the store is Scott Guthrie, Corporate Vice President of Windows Azure, and he's ready to kick off and lead you through this journey. So sit back, relax, and enjoy. Thank you.
Good morning, and welcome to Azure Week. My name is Scott Guthrie. I work on the Windows Azure team here at Microsoft, and I'm going to be spending the next sort of roughly 75 to 90 minutes with you walking you through Windows Azure, which is Microsoft's cloud computing platform, and talk through some of the great opportunities you can start taking advantage of with it today. So we're going to see kind of a broad overview in terms of what it's providing, a whole bunch of demos showing off how you can use it. Again, hopefully leave you with, after the end of this talk, a pretty good understanding of what are some of the things you can do with it and what your appetite to attend some of the other great sessions that we're going to be having here this week. Or if you're watching after the fact, they'll be available online to download. So with that, let's go ahead and get started. So again, my name is Scott Guthrie. I help run the Windows Azure team. Again, what we're going to do is spend a little bit of time walking through what is Windows Azure and how you can go ahead and start taking advantage of it. So what is Azure in a nutshell? Well, basically, why should you even care about Azure? At a high level, Windows Azure is Microsoft's cloud computing platform. And it provides a really powerful way that can really help transform your business and the types of applications you want to build to support it. A couple key things it enables. One is the ability to move really fast. One of the things you're going to see throughout the demos I'm doing here today is just a lot of cases where you're going to see things that today might, in an on-premises traditional environment, might take you weeks or days to stand up. We're going to be able to create literally, in some cases, in seconds, whether they're databases, virtual machines, websites, etc. And this ability to instantly spin up the resources you need, the ability to have pre-built services that you can leverage, basically just makes development a lot of fun and enables you to move really, really quickly. You're also going to see, and I'll talk a little bit about throughout today, how you can save money with Windows Azure. One of the things I always ask people when they start thinking about the cloud and trying to figure out, well, how is it going to help me save money, is ask, you know, if you look at your average servers within your on-premises environments or even in a hosted environment, and you look at what is the typical CPU utilization on those servers, you know, for most people, it tends to be about 10 to 15% average CPU utilization. And that's because there's times of the day when their servers aren't very busy. There's times of the day when the employees are at home or asleep. Or there's times of the day when, you know, the end users that are actually visiting the sites and those applications, you know, also aren't available. And so people tend to, you know, build out for peak, but the majority of the time, or for large periods of the time, they tend to be fairly quiet in terms of utilization. In an on-premises world where you actually have your own box that you're paying for, you always end up having to pay for that peak usage even if it's not being leveraged. The great thing about the cloud world is you can dynamically spin up and spin down resources based on only what you need. And in the cloud world, you only pay for what you use, which means that in those off-peak periods, you can actually automatically cycle down your servers or run them at lower utilization and pocket that money. And for most applications, you'll find that leads to a tremendous cost savings over what you do today. And then the other great thing about Windows Azure is it maintains what we call hybrid consistency. And this allows you to use the same programming models, the same core tools, and the same languages that you use with your Windows servers and SQL and .NET today on-premise. You can also now run in the cloud and take advantage of those same things as well. And you can build applications that can run both on-premises and in the cloud. And as I'll talk a little bit about later today, you can also build applications that can span both the cloud and on-premises environments. and really take the best of both worlds and really leverage them together. The end result we think is pretty differentiated. It's hopefully pretty exciting. And if you're a developer or an IT administrator watching this video, hopefully you'll leave over the next hour or so with a good sense of, wow, this is how I can get started and here's some of the cool things I can do. So where does Windows Azure run? So Windows Azure runs inside Microsoft data centers that are distributed around the world. And we have a number of what we call regions that consist of multiple data centers that are close together. And what this map is showing you here is all of the regions that we've announced or have running today with Windows Azure. You can see here there's several running in North America. We have several in Europe. We have a whole bunch in Asia. We have new ones coming up in South America and in Australia, as well as Japan. And when you're a developer inside with Windows Azure, you can basically choose to run and deploy your applications to any of these regions around the world. And so you literally can basically just, within the dev tool or in that environment, you basically just point where do you want to go ahead and deploy and run it, and we'll actually deploy and run that application in that particular location. So the beauty here is, regardless of where you are situated around the world, you can choose to run your applications anywhere else around the world, and you have full control over that deployment and that location that you run your system. The other thing that's nice about Windows Azure is you'll notice we often have clusters of regions in the same continent. So for example, in North America, we have 5 regions. In Europe, we have 2. And you can see kind of 2 in Japan, 2 in Australia, et cetera. And what's nice about that is each of our regions are at least 500 miles away from each other. And so those 2, for example, in Europe means that you can actually build and run your application in one or even both of those regions inside Europe. And the benefit of running in both those regions is that you can basically maintain kind of what we call disaster isolation, so that even in the event of a bad storm or a bad natural disaster that might impact a particular region, you know that there's at least another region that's several hundred miles away where you can actually go ahead and run your application. That just gives you a little bit more peace of mind to know that you can survive natural disasters, because they do happen around the world from time to time. And that you always have choice and flexibility within any particular governmental or sovereignty area, that you can then run your application in multiple spots. So we talked a little about where you can run your application. Let's talk a little bit about some of that saving money again, because I think that is something that, again, a lot of people ask about and kind of really want to understand, because it sounds pretty good. How does that work? Well, again, as I mentioned earlier, you pay only for what you use. So basically, when you deploy an application in any of those regions, you're only paying for literally the minutes that you use them for. There's no upfront costs. You don't have to buy any licenses when you use Windows Azure. You don't have to have a Windows or SQL license already to use it. You can just literally walk up to the website, sign up, and immediately start deploying assets. As I mentioned, we do per-minute billing, which basically means, you know, you pay only for what you use literally to the minute that you use it. So if you spin up a virtual machine and run it for 12 minutes, you only pay for 12 minutes of utilization. You don't have to pay the full hour. You certainly don't have to pay for a full server. And so the benefit there, again, saves you a lot of money. We don't charge for stop VMs. So if at any point you decide to power down your virtual machines or your websites or your mobile services inside Azure, the billing stops at that point for any of your CPU compute. And as I mentioned earlier, it's really easy to get started. And since we've talked enough already, let's actually dive into some demos, and actually let's take a look at it in action. So what I'm going to do here is escape out here and go into my other machine, where we're going to dive, visit the Windows Azure website, which I have loaded up here. It's just so you can go to azure.com and type it in, and you can literally follow along what I'm doing here. And basically our website, we talk a little bit about, you know, some of the things that we provide and some of the differentiation we have. We have a nice documentation center that you can visit later, and it has a nice SDK sections for different languages and tools. So you can see we have SDKs, great SDKs for .NET, Visual Studio, a really good tutorial that helps you get started that you can walk through step by step in order to build applications. So a pretty easy way to get started. And you can learn about pricing, and you can download the SDKs and other things throughout the website. What I'm going to do though now, is actually visit our free trial page. And actually sign up for a free trial. And to do that, I'm just going to go ahead and click this free trial link. And you can see here, I got a simple page. I can just go ahead and click this Try It Now button and walk through signing up for Azure. And it takes only about a minute or two to do. Once you do that, you basically get a free 30-day account on Azure that you can use across any type of resource. We basically give you $200 worth of Azure resources that you can then go ahead and spend these credits of $200 on any resource inside Azure. So you can create virtual machines, websites, databases, etc. Everything we're going to show you today, and in fact this week, is all live and inside Azure today. And so literally just by doing this free trial, you can sign up and you can immediately start doing it yourself. Now I'm already signed up, and so one of the things that you can do if you're signed up, you just click this portal link at the very top of the website, in the top right. And once you do that, it's going to sign you into our admin console, or admin portal. This is what it looks like right here. And it basically, it's a browser-based UI that lets you manage and see all the different types of resources that you've created and you're already using inside Azure. And so when you first sign up, it'll be blank. You can just go ahead and click this new button in order to create a new resource. And you'll notice here I have a whole bunch of resources that are already created, and they're just populated inside this list. Well, tell you what we're going to do is let's go ahead and kick off and create some new things and walk through them here inside our portal. So we'll start by going to the new button here. This is how you create new resources inside Azure. And you can see I create a website, virtual machine, mobile service. We've got databases. We've got caching servers and media streaming, and a whole bunch more. And we're going to walk through a lot of these different resources throughout the day. I'm just going to kick things off, though, with something simple, which is a new virtual machine. And I can use a gallery, which gives me kind of a nice view of a whole bunch of images and a whole bunch of advanced options that I can use. And you can see here we've got images for Windows Server. There's a whole bunch of SQL images that I can use, including the new SQL 2014, if you just want to try that out. SharePoint, BizTalk. You can, in fact, if you're an MSDN customer, you can install and use Visual Studio 2013 inside a virtual machine. We also then have Ubuntu OSs. We've got CentOS. We've got SUSE. We've got Oracle, including databases and app servers. All of these images are available, and you can just go ahead and literally click one and walk through a wizard to do it. You can walk through this sort of more advanced wizard through the gallery, or if you just want to do it super simple, just use the quick create option that's available inside the portal here. So I'm just going to call this SkyGooTest. Looks like I've already used that name, so SkyGooTest99. I can pick the image I want to use. I can choose the size of the virtual machine I want to create. So I could just start off with a single core image there. And then what I can do is just add a password that I want the virtual machine to have. I can pick now where in the world I want to deploy it. So let's deploy it in the east half of the United States. And just hit create. And that's literally all I need to do in order to spin up a new virtual machine in the east region of the United States. And basically within about 3 minutes, our virtual machine will be fully provisioned. And I'll be able to go ahead and click on it, log in, and start to use it as a full administrator on the system. Now, just so we don't have to wait those 3 minutes, I'm just going to go ahead and click on a virtual machine I created earlier called VM0 here. And so you can see I've launched into the portal. The nice thing about once you create a resource in Azure is we give you a bunch of diagnostic information about it. And so you can see inside this view here, I can see the CPU utilization of this virtual machine, the network, the disk I.O. that's happening within it, all within this nice, easy-to-use dashboard. So it makes it really easy to kind of understand what exactly is going on. I can also click this monitor tab where I can add a whole bunch of more metrics to the dashboard. And so I can kind of see exactly what I want to do and configure it. And those will all surface directly inside this view. I can shut down the VM or reboot it, or you'll notice here I have a nice little connect button, which is what I'm going to click right now. And when I click this, it's going to download a remote desktop or RDP file. I can go ahead and hit open. I can then log in using whatever username password I've set up earlier on that virtual machine. And what you're going to see here in just a second is this VM0 virtual machine that I created earlier, we're now remote desktoping into, and I'm now an admin on that box. And so this is basically a virtual machine running inside Azure with Windows Server 2012. And I'm a full administrator on the machine, so I can install anything I want within it. I can go ahead and install SQL or SharePoint or IIS or any custom things I want. If it was a Linux machine, I could go ahead and install, Redis or MySQL or any other Linux package on it as well. A couple things you can also do that are kind of nice about this is if I wanted to, I could go back into our portal here and I could attach a drive. And so you can see I can attach an existing disk, or I could just go ahead and say I want to attach another empty disk to this virtual machine. You can pick and say I want it to be 500 gigabytes in size. And if you just click OK, it'll go ahead and provision for us a 500 gigabyte volume that'll then be attached as a device into that OS. And once you do that, you can then go back into your virtual machine and just format it like a regular NTFS volume if you're in Windows, or an EXT volume if you're on Linux and mount it as a device. And then again, you can store anything you want within those drives. All of the data and all of the drives and storage that you use within virtual machines in Azure are persistent, which means even if you reboot this virtual machine, the data will still be there the next time it reboots. So again, very easy way for you to create a virtual machine, remote desktop into it, attach any drives you want to it. A little bit later on, we'll talk about some of the networking options that we have as well. And so you can attach network, you can configure DNS, you can do all those things, you know, basically using the same types of skills that you have today to manage virtual machines on premise. And again, you can do it for both Windows as well as Linux. So we'll close this out here, but you can see, again, a pretty easy way you can go ahead and take advantage of this virtual machine and do whatever you want with it. Last couple things I'll just mention before we click back into slides is you can click this Configure tab. A couple things you can do that are neat on this Configure tab is you can configure the size of the virtual machine that's run. So we created that virtual machine. In fact, if you look, that virtual machine that we just kicked off is still deploying, it looks like. But once it's deployed, you remember we configured it to be a small VM inside that quick start menu. If I wanted to later change the size, I can just go into this Configure tab and I could say, hey, I want to run on an 8-core system. And all you need to do is just hit Save. Azure will prompt you, do you really want to do this? If you say yes, it'll reboot the virtual machine, now running as an 8-core 56 gig system. That's how easy it is in order to increase or decrease the capacity being used by your virtual machine. And the beauty is, because you only, again, only pay for what you use, you could start small if you think your database is just going to be used for dev test or used for a relatively small tier 2 app. As it becomes more popular and you realize, hey, I'm starting to peg the CPU more, you can just go ahead and steadily increase the amount of CPU or the amount of memory available to that virtual machine. And you're only paying for the cores and the memory that you use at any particular minute. And so you only have to pay again for what you actually need, as opposed to have to over-provision the virtual machine up front. You know, that's a nice feature that Windows Azure provides. Again, makes it super easy for you to go ahead and scale basically only as you need to, and save a whole bunch of money by not over-provisioning. So we're going to go back to our slides now. Let's talk about some of the other cool features we have with virtual machines and what you can take advantage of. So, you know, summarize again what I talked about earlier in terms of capabilities here. You can run both Windows and Linux with virtual machines. So you can basically use whatever OS you want. You can run anything inside those virtual machines you want. So there's no restriction on what software you use within it. You can install any database, you can install any app server, you can install any framework or any language. And you can run these machines standalone, meaning they're each a unique machine with their own IP address on the internet. Or what you can do is you can take advantage of a cool feature we have called virtual private networking and some of the other networking kind of capabilities that we provide built in. And this allows you to take these virtual machines, put them together, and actually have an application that consists of multiple machines with a bunch of cool advanced options. Let's talk about a couple of those that you can take advantage of. One of the things that you know, we hear from a lot of customers that they want to be able to do is be able to take multiple machines and stitch them together and enable what's called load balancing across them. And we have a cool feature called load balancing that's built into Azure, and we also have a cool feature called availability sets that enables you to run those virtual machines in a highly available, reliable way. And I'm going to spend a little bit of time in this graphic talking through how you set that up, and then we'll look back in the portal and how you configure it. So let's talk about each of these features separately. The first one here is called an availability set. And the idea behind an availability set is it allows you to deploy your virtual machines in Azure and run each of those virtual machines on separate, what we call fault domains, or isolation units. And so for example, if I have two or three virtual machines, I might want to make sure that they're each running on separate physical servers so that in the event of a server failure, I wouldn't lose all of my virtual machines at once. And this is a cool feature that's built into Azure. It basically means that you can create a virtual machine or two virtual machines, put them into what's called an availability set, and we'll make sure that we isolate them on separate physical machines, and we'll make sure that we even have two separate top-of-rack routers available, so that even if we lose the network or there's a hardware network failure, we can still preserve and make sure that your at least some of your virtual machines are still up and your application can remain unaffected. We then have load balancing support so that you can go ahead and configure a single IP address to the outside world and make sure that the traffic to that IP address is distributed across those virtual machines, across your availability set, or across your Azure regions. The benefit about that means is, you know, if one of these servers fails, the load balancer will automatically take it out of rotation, so it stops sending traffic to it, and your other machines can still handle the load. And better yet, Azure will then spin up another instance of your virtual machine on a completely separate server, and then bring it back into the network rotation and continue along. And that ability to do it kind of for you all automatically is kind of a nice feature that we have built in and enables you to kind of build much more available and reliable systems. So how do we configure that? Well, let's go back into our Azure portal. Setting up load balancing, setting up an availability set is really easy. All I need to do to create an availability set here is I just go to the Configure tab of a virtual machine, and you'll notice I can create a new availability set, or if I already got one, I can add this virtual machine into it. And so you'll notice here I've got a VM0 and a VM1 virtual machine. And if I go back here, you can see there's VM0, there's VM1. I can click into each of those. By going to the Configure tab, I can add them into this web server availability set that I just named web availability set. If I had database servers, I could add them into a database availability set. And just by doing that and hitting save, this will now make sure that my machines are in separate availability sets. And that way, if I have a server failure, only one of those two virtual machines should ever be affected. Even if I have a network failure, only one of those two virtual machines should ever be affected, and the other machine will be up and available and working just fine. We also use this availability set concept so that every time we patch the underlying host operating system of the machine that's hosting the virtual machine, we always bring down the virtual machines one at a time inside the availability set, so you never have to worry about, if we're doing, say, a patch update, ever bringing down both virtual machines simultaneously. So again, this is a nice way you can add high availability into your system. Clicking on the Endpoints tab allows you to configure what external ports are available from these virtual machines to the outside world. And so if you want, you can add a new endpoint or port that you want to configure. I already have an HTTP one that's loaded, so let's just click Edit on that. And you'll notice I have port 80 exposed. And if I go ahead and select this, you'll notice that if I scroll down here, I have both VM0 and VM1 open up on this port 80 port. And so this is now, every time port HTTP request comes to this DNS, it's going to distribute that load automatically between the two separate VMs. And you'll notice right here I have this thing called a probe setup. And that basically means that the load balancer is going to ping my web servers running in those virtual machines every 15 seconds. If after two attempts that web server is not responding, it'll automatically remove it from the load balancer rotation so that no additional traffic is sent to that virtual machine. And again, this is a way that, again, if my app is having a problem or my server's having a problem or my virtual machine's having a problem, Azure can automatically stop sending traffic to it, let it repair, and then once it's back up and running, we'll again start sending traffic like normal. And so it makes it really easy for you to go ahead and configure all this and be able to run it in a very reliable way. Last thing I'll just mention here is you'll notice this Manage ACL button. This is also a way you can go ahead and now set ACLing rules. So you can say, for example, I want to permit or deny access from a particular IP address or a subnet range. And this is another nice way you can do on any of our open ports so that you can go ahead and control exactly who's allowed access to which virtual machine and run everything in a very secure way. By default, we actually turn off all ports, so you have to explicitly add, for example, the ports, in this case here, HTTP and RDP, onto the virtual machine. But even once you add it, you can then go ahead and manage the ACLs, so you can say this port is open, again, only for machines accessing it from a certain IP address range, as a way you can add even more security on top of your instances. And again, all this is nicely built in, and you can take advantage of it in a really easy way. So that's a little bit about availability sets and load balancers. Let's talk now about another cool feature that we have built into Azure we call virtual networking. So again, you can run these virtual machines anywhere you want around the world, and you can have them be kind of standalone virtual machines where they talk together over public IP addresses. The other cool thing that we have support for those is something we call virtual networks. And with a virtual network, you can actually effectively define your own virtual network or your own private network where you can have any IP address range you want. It doesn't actually have to be exposed to the public internet at all, so it can be completely private. And it allows you to do machine-to-machine communication, again, over this private network so that only the machines that are on the private network can talk to each other. This is great for kind of security scenarios where you want to go ahead and have like your web servers talk to your database servers and make sure your database servers don't have to be exposed on the public internet. It's also really great for cases where you want to go ahead and connect the machines you're running inside Windows Azure to your on-premises corporate network or some other data center around the world where you're already running machines. And what you can basically do is create a virtual network inside Azure. You can go ahead and tunnel to that network that's running in that corporate environment and securely tunnel over the internet. And then you can basically have the machines talk to each other over private IP addresses that only are available to your machines. In addition to supporting the ability to tunnel over the internet, you can also go ahead and now take advantage of our dedicated fiber option within Windows Azure, we call ExpressRoute. And what that lets you do is you can basically get a lease line or a fiber connection from, say, AT&T or Equinix or your other telecommunications provider. And at that point, all of the communication from your on-premises environment to Windows Azure is going over your own private fiber link to us. That means nothing goes over the public internet, you can make sure that all your data is fully secure, again, everything's going over your own private fiber that you've leased from your telecommunications provider. So that gives you even additional kind of guarantees around performance. It can also make you feel a little bit better around security and isolation as well. Now, for this virtual network capability, though, and you can try out this virtual network all using the trial that you sign up for. This one doesn't require private fiber. Again, you can use the private fiber if you have one, but most people don't get private fiber for the first 30-day trial. If you just want to use the trial, you can basically connect and set up what's called a site-to-site virtual private network tunnel. This allows you to have any number of machines running in your corporate environment connected here to Azure. Again, we also have this nice option we call point-to-site. And what this lets you do is, once you enable it, you can basically tunnel from your desktop machines, including your dev environments, into a virtual private network running inside Azure. And this basically provides a really nice way for dev test environments or cases where we have developers that are working remotely at home, where they can go ahead and attach themselves into that Azure environment and be able to very easily go ahead and debug as well as work with those systems. So both a variety of different options you can take advantage of really powerful solution that you can use. So let's talk about the last thing here, which is command line automation. And basically one of the things kind of I've shown a lot of right now inside Windows Azure here is how you can go ahead and configure everything using our nice admin portal. So we'll go back to that. Then again, you can basically configure virtual machines, databases. We talked about virtual networks. Let me just go ahead and click on this virtual network tab here. You can see I can go into my virtual network. And the same way I can see my virtual machines, you can see I have a virtual network defined. I could create a new one just by saying new virtual network, quick create, and define one. I could add machines to it. Again, I can configure certificates. I can do everything through the portal, which is a really great way you can go ahead and just sort of explore and learn about all the different features that we have. But one of the things I want to make sure you also leave knowing is that everything you do through the portal, you can also do from the command line as well. And so you can fully script everything as well, so you don't actually have to have any human interaction to change any of these things, and you can fully automate it so that at a later point you can immediately reproduce exactly what you've done over and over again in a repeatable way. And there's a variety of different ways you can do that. One is through PowerShell. So you can see here I've got a simple little PowerShell script where if I wanted to, I could go ahead and say, Let's create a virtual set of virtual machines. They're going to use this VM image. I'm going to have them be part of this web availability set. I'm going to have, say, 20 virtual machines added to it, each of size small. And you can see here, I could basically, with this little for loop, just go ahead and create a new virtual machine. I could then go ahead and, once it's created, tunnel into it. And you'll notice here in this PowerShell script, I'm going ahead and installing IIS and configuring it with the inet pub directory all set up. And so literally, you know, in a matter of just a little couple lines of PowerShell script, I can go ahead and fully configure a web farm of 20 virtual machines, all running an availability set, all with a load balancing endpoint set up, all configured based on a custom Windows VM image with IIS and whatever application I want within it. And I can just kick off the script, and literally in a matter of minutes, I've got my web farm completely configured. In the same way, I could go ahead and create new IIS VMs, I could create SQL databases, etc. Everything inside Azure can be configured this way. And what's cool is, if you go to the Windows Azure website, visit our documentation center, in addition to having a whole bunch of documentation for our language SDKs and by service, you'll notice there's little, this little automation, automated script section. These are popular scripts that we have already pre-written that you can visit, or you can visit our script center to find out more scripts available there. And so you can see if I want to create a virtual machine with two data drives, that's one popular script. Go ahead and click it, and you can see here we've got the script that you can check out. You can copy and paste it or download it. And it makes it really easy to do common operations, or what I commonly do is just download the script and then tweak the settings and combine them so that I can basically automate everything myself. And again, the scripting center makes it really easy for you to figure out how to do all this stuff. And you can visit and start using it on our Windows Azure website today. So, we've talked a little bit about using Azure here with virtual machines. And obviously, with virtual machines, you can run a whole bunch of production software and systems within them. You can go ahead and run public website, you can run a database, you can do a bunch of things. The other thing that's kind of cool about running a with Windows Azure, though, is the ability for you to also go ahead and use these virtual machines for what we call dev test scenarios. And so this is cases where you want to basically spin up a virtual environment that you're going to go ahead and use for with Visual Studio or with any other language environment in order to go ahead and remote desktop, run and develop and test your app. So you could use these for build servers or integration servers if you want to run your tests. You could run them for stress tests, perf tests, pretty much anything you want. You can go ahead and spin up these virtual machines and use them for those types of environments. A couple of things that are cool about Windows Azure is that every MSDN customer, if you're an MSDN subscriber, gets free Azure benefits that you can take advantage of. And basically what that means is that when you sign up for Azure, if you sign up using the same Live ID or Microsoft ID that you have associated with your MSDN account, you don't need to use a credit card, you don't even get asked for a credit card, you can immediately sign up to Azure. And what we do is we basically give you two nice benefits. One is we give you big savings off of the standard VM rates. In fact, up to 97% savings over the standard rates. So it's the cheapest way to run virtual machines, far cheaper than Amazon or Rackspace or any other cloud provider out there. We also then give you what are called MSDN credits that you can then return additional dollars that you can then spend on any Azure resource. What this basically means is if you're an MSDN professional customer, you get $50 of credits a month. If you're a premium customer, you get $100 a month. And if you're an ultimate customer, you get $150 a month. And that's enough where, for example, if you're a premium customer and you get $100 a month, you could spin up three virtual machines and run them 24/7 for like about 20, 25 days of the month, or 16 hours a day for 31 days of the month. You could run up to 500 web apps plus a SQL database, all at no cost every single month. And these credits get paid out to you every single month, and you can basically spend them on anything you want within Azure. So they could be virtual machines, they could be Hadoop clusters, they could be databases, media streaming, you name it, you can go ahead and take advantage of it. And so it's definitely something to leverage if you're an MSDN subscriber. Makes it a lot easier for you to go ahead and build applications. And the great thing is if you're an MSDN subscriber, you already have these free credits that you're getting. You might as well take advantage of them. So the other thing that's kind of cool is once you're inside the Azure portal, at any point you can click this little credit status at the top, and it'll tell you exactly how many of your MSDN credits are remaining. So it makes it really easy as well for you to go ahead and tell, you know, how many hours have I used, or how many of those dollars have I used each month, and how many days are remaining of those credits before they're replenished. And if you want to, you can drill in and you can click and see detailed burn down rate of exactly how much of those credits that you've used. So it makes it really easy again for you to go ahead and start using your services. You'll notice here I have an MSDN account. All I have to do is just click at the top of the portal on the credit status. It tells me I've got $87 worth of credits remaining this month. And in 18 days, I'll get another $150 that I can then go ahead and spend on anything I want. So it makes it, again, a really easy way for me to figure out how much I have remaining. There's never a surprise bill. And if you're an MSDN subscriber, by default, we enable what's called a credit limit, which basically means that if you ever burn down through all of your credits, we'll make sure that we never bill you for any overages. We'll actually just suspend the account until the next cycle by default. And so again, you can sign up, you don't need a credit card, and you never have to worry about ever getting a surprise bill at the end of the month because we basically guarantee that we'll never bill you. If you want to, you can turn that off and you can use additional services on top of the free credits that you provide, but that's optional. And if you do turn it off and you want to take advantage of additional services, we also have a cool feature that any customer that uses Azure can now take advantage of, which is called email billing alerts. And so you can also set it up so that if your bill ever goes above a certain amount, say $25 a month, we'll automatically email you a notification that says, hey, you're approaching your limit or you've hit that $25 limit, just want to let you know. So again, you can also set up these automated alerts. So again, there's never a surprise at the end of the month with what your bill looks like. So definitely take advantage of that if you're an MSDN customer. Again, you can sign up and immediately start using this today if you already have a Microsoft ID associated with your MSDN account. If you're an organization where your employees don't get the actual Microsoft ID associated with your MSDN benefit, and instead you just have a central administrator within your enterprise that signs up for MSDN and just gives you the MSDN software directly. One thing you can also do is ask them to go into the MSDN benefits portal, and they can now assign an Active Directory username to each MSDN subscription. You know, you could be Microsoft/ScottGoo, might be your Active Directory name if you were me. And what that then lets you do is you can actually go and still sign up for Azure now using your corporate account. So I could sign up as ScottGoo@Microsoft.com as opposed to a Hotmail or an Outlook.com live ID. And I'd sign in using my Microsoft password. And at that point, then I'd have a corporate account with Azure that was still tied to my MSDN benefits. And the benefit there is it means that from your IT perspective, all their employees are logging in using the same Active Directory username password that they use for their on-premise systems. And if that developer ever leaves the organization, they lose access to their MSDN account. But you're still now able to use your MSDN benefits and get those free credits associated with each of those accounts, even if that employee is logging in using their Active Directory ID. So again, no reason not to use your MSDN benefits with Azure, regardless of whether or not you use have access to the MSDN Microsoft ID, or whether you sign in just using your enterprise corporate Active Directory account. Both of those work great. You can take full advantage of your MSDN benefits when you do it. So this is a little bit about infrastructure. We spent kind of the first sort of half, if you will, of this talk talking a lot about infrastructure, and hopefully you left here knowing virtual machines, private networks, load balancing endpoints, ACLs on IP addresses. You can configure all of that. You can basically run any type of app you want. And again, you can take advantage of your MSDN benefits in order to spin up that type of environment to use for dev test or for production. What I'm going to switch gears, though, is actually talk not just so much about the infrastructure pieces we have in Azure, which are powerful and you've seen, but a lot about what we call our app capabilities that we provide as well. And the goal behind these kind of managed services that we provide, or app services that we provide, is that they enable you to focus more on app development and not have to worry as much about the infrastructure plumbing. And so in this world, rather than have to spin up a virtual machine that you deploy a database into, as an example, I could just go ahead and create a managed database using Azure, where we're taking care of patching and hosting that database for you automatically. And you can focus much more on the app and your app development experience, where you just go ahead and consume that database and let us do a lot of that administration work for you. And what's great about Azure is we have tons and tons of these built-in managed services that you can take advantage of. So they could be databases, they could be Hadoop clusters, they could be storage accounts, they could be caches or content delivery network or CDN edge locations, directory servers, BizTalk services, media encoding, web app and mobile hosting. All of these are features that exist today with Azure. And we're going to walk through just a couple of these over the next 45 minutes or so. And I think you'll leave going, wow, this makes development a lot easier. And the great thing about Azure is you can combine these things and use them standalone. You can combine them with virtual machines. And so you can choose to have infrastructure, to have these managed services. You can have just infrastructure, just managed services. Or what's really powerful is you can put them all together so that you can build solutions where you might use some VMs, but also use some managed services. And again, you can use them across Windows, across Linux, across any programming language, and you can compose them really nicely. And the end result, we think, is a really special offering. So let's see a couple examples of this in action. First, kind of example of a managed service I want to use, because I think it kind of illustrates some of the power and the ease of use that they provide, is our SQL database option. Basically, what this lets you do is lets you stand up a fully managed relational database running inside Windows Azure. And so basically it's the same programming model as SQL Server. It's the same SQL Server engine that you'd run in an on-premises environment or inside a virtual machine today. But what's nice about it is you don't have to think about it as a virtual machine. Instead, you can think of it as a service where we're doing the patching for you. We're doing the backup. We're running antivirus, all the standard things that are best practices to run on top of a database. And we cluster the database for high availability reasons. And that basically means we're running it across multiple physical servers. So again, even in the event of a drive failure or in the event of a server failure, we can basically make sure that your database is still available and is still ready to use. And it's really easy to get started. And what you'll see here is takes just seconds in order to go ahead and create it. So let's go ahead and try that in action. So I'm going to go and go back to the Windows Azure portal here. Now, if I want to create a virtual machine, again, I can create it in one of two ways. I can go ahead and create it as a virtual machine. And so you can say new virtual machine from gallery. And if you remembered earlier, we have a little SQL Server set of templates. And so I can pick the version of SQL Server I want to run. And I could choose, you know, what size virtual machine I want it. And I can give an admin password. And this will spin up a virtual machine that has SQL Server already running inside of it that I can now go ahead and use as a database. And that's an example of kind of a virtual machine or infrastructure way in order to handle it. Now, the benefit with that is I have full control over the database. So I can put anything I want inside that database. I can manage that virtual machine however I want. The downside, though, is I have full control over that database, which means I'm responsible for backing it up and doing all of the kind of DBA activities that you'd expect on top of that virtual machine. But it's still a nice option to have. What I'm going to show you now is how to take advantage of our SQL database service option, which is another way you can go ahead and spin up a database. Instead of clicking Compute Virtual Machine, instead, I'm just going to go ahead and click Data Services, SQL Database. And I can do a custom create option, or in this case here, I'm just going to do a quick create. And I'll just call this the Scott Goo Test DB. Name it whatever I want. I can choose which server I want to run it on. So I'm just going to run this in the West US region. And I'm going to go ahead and hit create. Now, before I hit create, think to yourself for just a moment, like when you create a database today or ask your IT department to create a database for you, how long does it take before they spin up a server that you can go ahead and use this database within? You know, does it usually take hours? Does it take days? Does it take weeks? Does it take months? For a lot of enterprises, it typically is at least a couple days. Sometimes it's a couple weeks in order to actually spin up a database that you can go ahead and use. And you got to fill out forms, and sometimes you have to buy licenses, and you have to do a lot of kind of back and forth, sometimes bureaucracy, in order to do it. Now, if you're a developer using Windows Azure or you're an administrator using Windows Azure, you can literally just click Data Services, SQL Database, Quick Create, and then just click the create button. Let's count how long it's going to take now. So 1-1000, 2-1000, 3-1000, 4-1000, 5-1000, done, 5 seconds. That's literally how long it took us to do. We now have the ScottGoo TestDB database created, and we're now ready and we're in business. So literally 5 seconds, we now have a database. This has the database loaded. This is all ready. You'll notice here, here's my server. If I click on the dashboard view, just like you saw with virtual machines earlier, we have a nice little dashboard view. Because I'm focusing as a, this is my service view though, instead of showing you, disk I/O and how much memory is being used, instead we're actually focusing on a very much more of a database view of this infrastructure. So you notice here we've got, we'll show you how many deadlocks have happened, how many failed connections, how many successful connections to this database. So just the stuff you need to care about as a database user or administrator. I can grab my connection strings to start programming against it. And you'll notice we've got .NET, ODBC, PHP, and Java available. Basically I can click this manage link, or I can connect to this using the SQL Server Management Studio that I'm already familiar with and use on-premise. I can now manage that database as well, this database we just created, using those same set of tools. Or if I'm a Visual Studio user, I can also connect to this database from the Windows the Visual Studio Server Explorer. And that's how easy it is to use. Literally in a matter of seconds, I've got a database fully provisioned and I'm off to the races and ready to go. If I later want to scale this database to make it bigger, I can just go click on the Scale tab here and I can choose what edition of the database I want to use. So right now it's a 1 gig database. In the web mode, I'm going to go up to the business database and make it 150 gigs. We'll go ahead and hit save. 1-1000, 2-1000, took 2 seconds. And now that database is now 150 gigs in size. And usually when I show people this, I was telling someone last week and they said, well, what just happened? It's now 150 gigs? Or is that a ticket to ask someone to increase it? No. We just scaled it to be 150 gigs. It's now ready to be used. It's 150 gigs. That wasn't queuing up some work item. That literally was all the work that was necessary in order to make this database now 150 gigs in size. If I want to scale it back down and realize, oh, I don't really need it that big, just go ahead and hit save. And again, in about 2 seconds, that database is now 1 gigabyte in size. Because you only pay for what you're using, if you just keep the database at 1 gig for right now, you're only going to pay for a 1 gigabyte database. If in a couple months you need 150 gigs, you can always scale up the database as you need it, and you only pay for what you use. And so that, again, translates into a whole bunch of cost savings over what you get in a traditional hosted or on-premises environment. What's also nice about the SQL database option is it does not require you to have a SQL Server license. So you don't have to buy a SQL Server license. You don't already have to have bought one or have to use one. You literally can just go up to Azure, sign up, use your MSDN credits, or if you're not an MSDN subscriber, you can basically go ahead and sign up for the free trial. Create this database. You don't pay anything during the trial. But even after the trial is over, you don't have to pay much. A 1 gig database inside Windows Azure today costs you, I think it's about $9 a month. Total. That's it. That's for the hosting, that's for the database license, that's everything. Just $9 a month. If you use only, say, 100 gigabytes, it only costs you, I think, about $4 a month, $4.99 a month, and that's it. No license fee required. You don't have to buy SQL. You've got a full database there. And again, as you use more data, you pay a little bit more, but it's fairly reasonable, and I think you'll find it ends up being much more cost-effective than any other type of database hosting solution that you might find elsewhere. And that's how easy it is to use. So, that's sort of just one example, as I kind of mentioned, talking about some of these managed services. Database just happens to be one of many, many examples of services that you can go ahead and create and use. Again, makes it really easy for you to go ahead and spin anything up, take advantage of it in a very cost-effective way. And as a developer, have a lot of fun building apps with this way, because it's a lot more fun than having to wait or have a whole bunch of meetings to figure out whether or not you're allowed to use that infrastructure. So we talked about databases. Let's go ahead and switch gears now and talk some more about some of the other services that we provide and some of those other kind of managed environment capabilities that you can go ahead and leverage and use. Next one I'm going to talk about is something called websites. And basically with a website, it enables you to host and run a web app inside Azure. It's a managed service, so just like that SQL database option, I could create a virtual machine and put IIS in there. With the website option, I don't have to create a virtual machine though. Instead, I can just spin up a website and it will be fully managed for me, which means that IIS and Windows will be automatically patched as well as .NET on the server. I don't have to worry about kind of availability and load balancing rules and network IP address rules. All that's built in and taken care of for me with the website service. And instead, I can just focus on building my application, and I can very easily scale it up and scale it down using some of the built-in features that the web service system provides for me automatically. And we're going to go ahead and show some of those features in action. So I'm just going to go ahead here and go back into Windows Azure. And let's go ahead and create a new database that we can use. So just go ahead and create new. Again, I could create a virtual machine and manually install IIS inside it and set it all up. And we saw a little bit earlier on with that PowerShell script, as well as when we created that blank Windows Server VM, how easy it is to do that. What I'm going to do, though, instead is take advantage of this Managed Service option inside Azure and click New Website. And I can quickly create one of those managed website services that will handle all that infrastructure for me. And I can do it just like with a SQL database in a matter of seconds. So we're just going to call this ScottGoo Test Web. And I can choose where I want to run it in the world. So I'm just going to run it in the East US here. And I'm just going to go ahead and hit Create. And you'll see it takes about 10 seconds. So you'll see about halfway there. And done. It's created. There's that ScottGoo Test Web site that's been created and is ready for me. And I now have a website up and running that I can go ahead and use. You see when I click on the dashboard view, we've got a kind of a nice view that shows me things like CPU time, data in, data out, the number of errors, etc. So a nice kind of view that makes it really easy for me to see the health of my service. Now, right now I don't have any app deployed in it. So let's go into Visual Studio and change that. And we'll just close this project. I'm just going to create a new project. I'm going to use the ASP.NET web application template. We'll call it the ScottGoo Test Web. Can use whatever template I want. I could use web forms, I could use MVC, I could use web pages. I could also use PHP or Node.js or Python as well if I want to use other languages or frameworks. In this case here, I'm just going to create though my standard, standard MVC project template here. And there we go. So this is created. And I'm just going to right-click and publish this to Azure. And so we have a built-in publish wizard that's built into VS 2013, or you can download the Azure SDK, and it works on VS 2012 and I think VS 2010 as well. And you can just go ahead and right-click and hit publish. And then what's cool is you can go ahead and hit import here, and I can choose to deploy to any of the websites that I've created inside Azure. There's the ScottGoo Test Web app that we created just a few moments ago. Okay, it's going to download what's called some publish settings for me automatically. This is how I can go ahead and deploy it. I can now just go ahead and hit the publish button. And this is going to go ahead and start uploading content into that website that we created just a few moments ago. And once it's deployed, it's going to run it. And you should see here in about 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And so since someone on watching this video live was actually, I think, pounding on the site while I was deploying it. Something went wrong there. It would be normally going ahead and deployed. I'm not quite sure why that didn't work. Let's go ahead and make a change and see if we can redeploy that in order to fix it. I would just say another change. Beauty about doing this live. You can see here it's easy to make changes and redeploy things. And hopefully we're going to see here in just a second that it deployed live. And so usually you don't have thousands of people watching live hitting the server exactly in the moment you're deploying. And so I think what ended up happening was the app loaded before I'd actually uploaded everything in it. We're going to talk about a feature that we just shipped that actually will solve that for production sites a little bit later on. But you can see here that change actually thankfully fixed it. And you can see our another change text string that we made a modification to is now live, and anyone can actually now hit that site out there on the internet and can go ahead and pound on it and see it in production. And what's great is if I go back and now visit my website and my dashboard view, you'll notice here, yep, in fact, I am getting an awful lot of requests happening. And I can get kind of this nice real-time view that's actually showing how many people are actually hitting the server at any point in time. That updates at a one-minute granularity. And so as the site continually gets loaded and accessed, you'll see that that data is continually refreshing. And I basically now have a good sense now, another 170 people have all logged in. And again, you can kind of get a sense of how that site is doing and how it's scaling and being used. And the beauty is I can basically manage all this from my desktop here. And I now have a site out there on the internet that I can make changes to that anyone here watching can go ahead and access and use. And that basically is how easy it is in order to actually spin it up and start taking advantage of that web app. Now, if I want to do more advanced stuff, I could go back into this and I could manage domains. So I could map my own custom DNS entry to this website. So right now it's the scottgoo.testweb.azurewebsites.net. But if I wanted to, for example, I could go ahead and set this up to be, you know, mycustomdomain.com or .co.uk or any other extension that you wanted to. You can configure that. We also let you configure SSL endpoints. So if you go ahead here and click the Configure tab, you can go ahead and configure and manage SSL certificates. So if you scroll down here, you can upload an SSL cert, and it can either be an IP address-based SSL cert, in which case you'll get a unique IP address for your site, or it can be an SNI-based cert, SSL cert, in which case you can actually pool multiple SSL certs on a single IP address. Both of those are supported. And again, you can bind and configure all that in a really easy way. You can enable diagnostics, which we'll talk about how to do in a few minutes, and set all that up. You can enable what are called monitoring endpoints, which we'll also look at in just a few moments. What that lets you do is you can actually set it up so that this website gets pinged from a variety of different locations around the world, and we can send you automatic notifications and email anytime your site's having problems or appears down. So you can go ahead and configure that in a really easy way. You can manage and connect your connection strings, and they'll be encrypted for you. Change your default IIS settings and documents. Change your managed pipeline. You can turn on WebSockets and a whole bunch more. So all this stuff's really easy for you to go ahead and configure and enable. And again, you can do this all within this nice little dashboard. It looks like we've got 514 users have already tried hitting the site. So we're already starting to take a little bit of load on top of this system. So let's talk a little bit about some of the cool capabilities that this provides beyond just sort of basic web hosting and how we kind of think this differentiates a little bit as a service and some of the neat offerings that it has built in. So a couple things you can do. So one is obviously I showed a fairly easy way for you to go ahead and do publishing to it. A lot of people often ask, well, what's happening behind the scenes? Is there virtual machines running? You know, load balancing, how does that work? Well, the nice thing about this website service is it looks really easy to use, and it is really easy to use. You basically just create a website, deploy something into it, and away you go. What's nice about it is behind the scenes, though, is it's doing some pretty fancy stuff for you automatically. And it's enabling you to run kind of a site that can run in high scale and that you can really throw a lot of load and usage at in a high availability way. And what I'm going to show here is just a simple example of kind of what is happening behind the scenes when you're using this website service. So basically, let's say I deploy using Visual Studio or maybe a PowerShell script a new app or new website. This is going ahead and copying it for me onto the appropriate web servers. And behind the scenes, when I created a website, there's a set of virtual machines that are allocated to that website that I can go ahead and use. And so just by deploying it inside Visual Studio, this automatically did all the web deploy settings for me and made sure that .NET app, in this case, was deployed on top of virtual machines that were ready. It then also wired up a load balancer. And so now when browsers type in the DNS entry, rather than go directly to the virtual machine, it actually goes through a load balancing layer that's also managed by the website service. And what the website service will do is automatically route that request to a virtual machine and then go ahead and send the response back to the user. What's nice is if a whole bunch of traffic comes to my site, the load balancing layer inside the website service can automatically direct that load balance traffic to a variety of different machines. And so I can scale out my website to run across any number of VM instances that I want to basically have. And if I ever have a server failure, the website service will automatically remove that machine from rotation, spin up a new virtual machine for me, and start sending traffic to it. And the benefit there is I always have high availability. I always have a load-balanced infrastructure so that I can scale out my work. And I always have server monitoring enabled so that if I ever have a failure, either software or hardware of a virtual machine, all of the retry and all of the load-balanced rotation logic is built in for me. And the end result is I can focus on my app and take advantage of all this infrastructure in order to basically have a rock-solid delivery mechanism in order to run and have that app be available to people outside the world. And all that's built in, and you know, it looks really easy when we just created that website a few moments ago. You know, this is what's happening behind the scenes, and it's some really powerful stuff that you can leverage. Other cool thing that's built into Azure websites is the ability for you to easily scale those sites to handle lots of load. And so, for example, here, I could go ahead inside Windows Azure. And what's cool about our website feature is, let's look at this website again now. You can see here, and lots of users, 514 here. I can go ahead and click on the Scale tab. And since we're handling a lot of load, I might need to scale this thing up. And so you'll notice here I can basically run in what's called a free mode, in which case this is running with very minimal thing capability. I can run what's called shared mode or what's called standard mode. And when I run in standard mode, I can basically choose what size VM I want to run this in. So in this case here, I could say I want to run in a small VM size or medium or large. And I can choose how many instances I want to run this in. And so I could say I want to run this on 3 virtual machines, and all I have to do is hit save. And at that point, it will automatically scale out my site to run across 3 virtual machines. So really easy way I can scale up or scale down my number of virtual machines to handle whatever type of load that I'm actually receiving. Now the other option we have, which is pretty cool, is the CPU option. And what that lets you do is you can actually auto-scale your virtual machines to basically scale up and scale down based on the actual load that your site is seeing. So for example, if I wanted to, I could say I want to run this on at least 2 virtual machines and up to 7 virtual machines at any given point in time. And I could basically say I want to try to keep my memory usage or CPU usage between 30 and say 69%. And all I need to do is hit save. And once I do that, it's going to go ahead now and scale out this virtual set of machines for me in order to handle that. And what this means now is If I want to, I can basically automatically spin up these virtual machines based on my CPU load. And you can see here, enough people are hitting this site apparently on the video that I actually now have 3 virtual machines running. So I'm apparently getting an awful lot of traffic. Basically, this is just going to automatically start scaling up if my CPU is ever above 69%. And just keep adding virtual machines into rotation up to 7 VMs, because that's what I've configured as the max. After the show is over, my sense is my traffic is going to scale down or load is going to drop quite a bit. As soon as my CPU goes below 30% for a period of time, we'll start turning off virtual machines down to 2 VMs, which is what we've configured to be the minimum at all times. And so literally just by hitting save there, I can now scale up and I can scale down my virtual machines automatically and handle any amount of load. And the beauty there is, again, it's I'm only paying for what I'm actually needing. And you can see here, we even tell you in the portal, hey, because I'm running right now 3 virtual machines, I've saved up to 57% by setting up this auto scale rule. And the great thing is that auto scale rule is just a built-in feature of all standard-based websites. And so if you're running reserve mode or standard mode with Azure, you basically get this feature as a built-in capability, turn it on, and you can start saving a whole bunch of money by doing it. And the beauty here, again, is as your site gets hammered or hit quite heavily, you can go ahead and automatically scale up and scale down the traffic you need. You can see our site is starting to go crazy in terms of traffic, which is great. The beauty is my simple auto-scale rule is going to save me a bunch of money and make sure that I always have server capacity available in order to use. So that's a nice cool feature that's built into websites. Another cool feature that's built into websites that we just shipped last week that you can now start taking advantage of is something we call staging. And this is a pretty cool feature. And it actually would help with the problem that you saw a little bit earlier on where I tried deploying that website while I had hundreds of people hitting that URL apparently. And my site was in a partially deployed state where half the files had been deployed and the other half hadn't. And that's why we saw that little error message as the app was loaded while it was in that intermediate state. And what staging lets you do is it lets you set up for any particular website a staged version of the website that you can use in order to actually prop your content into, test it out, and then swap it into production in an atomic way so that users never see an intermediate version of the site. And setting up's really easy. All you need to do is just click this Enable Stage Publishing button. This is going to go ahead now and create a new website that'll be paired up with this Scott Yu test website. And if you click it here, you'll notice it just shows up in the portal underneath the main website. And if I go ahead and click on this, you can see this staged version of the website will show up in just a second. And it basically gives me a view so I can kind of see what I can go ahead and use. So I can click on, the Scott Yu test website here. We'll skip that. This is that production version. And then again, I can go back and click here on the staging version of the site. And once I do that, I can go ahead and click on the dashboard view, or I can click on the scale view, and I can configure and set up this website in order to deploy settings within it. And all I need to do at any point, but all I need to do at any point in order to swap these things is just go ahead and click the swap button. And so I can deploy stuff into my staged website, test it out, and then swap it into production and go back and forth between the two. And again, makes it really provides a really easy way that I can go ahead and deploy things, test it out, swap it, and make sure that no one is ever seeing that site in an intermediate state. And you know, that's how easy it was to create. If I swapped it right now, you'd see a blank site, so I'm not going to, because apparently I have now another 1,000 users that have signed up and visiting the site. But if that's how easy, if I wanted to swap it back and forth, I could do it. Makes it provide a really easy way. You can make sure that, your site's always available, and that you can go ahead and, very easily, manage it, coordinate it in a simple way. Other cool features that we have now built into websites that I should mention while we're here is this cool feature called Web Jobs. This is another neat feature that we just deployed, last week. And basically with a web job, you can go ahead and upload a background task into your website. And so this provides a way you can upload as a zip file and run this job continuously. It can be a little .exe file or it can be a script. And this is a really nice way you can run background tasks that, for example, pull things off of a queue or hit Twitter to download feeds that update in a database so that you never block your main web UI. The nice thing is you don't have to have a separate VM in order to run these tasks. You can now just upload them into an existing website, or you can just create a separate website and upload it there as well. And you can now run these background tasks as well. And all that's nicely built into the website model, and as a feature you can just take advantage of in a really easy way within your system. So we've talked about a whole bunch of these features, scaling, scale out. We've talked about the staging, production swap feature, web jobs, etc. Lots of really cool features you can take advantage of with websites. And generally we find the website feature tends to be one of the most popular features that people use with Azure, just because it just simplifies making web hosting really easy. And more importantly, it enables you to kind of take advantage of powerful features like autoscale, like staging and production, so that you can actually not only make it easy, but you can really do really powerful stuff with it. And that's where this next kind of set of flow I want to talk about also comes into play. And it's called our DevOps workflow. And what you'll find as you're kind of building for the cloud is now that you can spin up resources really easily, now that you can deploy things really easily, you can actually start to change your overall development workflow as well. And what you can do with this development workflow, it ends up being pretty powerful. It lets you basically, with DevOps, basically develop, deploy, operate, and learn in a continuous cycle, potentially multiple times throughout the day. So some people in a traditional world would deploy an app maybe only once a week or once every couple days. In a DevOps workflow, you can actually be deploying live multiple times a day, sometimes on every single check-in or every single build that you actually do of your site. And what's nice about this DevOps workflow is because you can do this in a continuous way, you can constantly make small changes, deploy it, immediately get feedback if you've got bugs or if your user engagement is dropping or improving, and you can learn, make another change based on that learning, and in a continuous way kind of make these small delta changes to your application and to constantly improve it. And the nice thing about having those small changes is that basically allow you to learn very quickly, really focus on the value within your application, and get immediate feedback as to whether or not your assumptions about features or assumptions about that value really pan off. If you build something you think is a really cool feature, but no one ends up using it, you'll find out immediately. And you can figure out, oh, let's make it more discoverable or invest more in making it people find it more. If you find a lot of people using the feature and then they abandon it, you know, wow, either we got the feature wrong or maybe that wasn't what people wanted. And again, you can choose to make your investment in your features in a much more accurate way. And because you're making small updates of code, the other really nice thing about that is it allows you to find and fix bugs much faster and easier because you know there's smaller code deltas. And so if you start seeing that there's more errors flying throughout the site or more exceptions happening, you know you can pinpoint what code change actually caused that, and you can immediately go ahead and fix it. And what's nice and what's kind of key to enabling this DevOps workflow is to have something that's repeatable, reliable, predictable, and lets you cycle throughout this time as fast as possible. And what's cool about Azure is we make it really easy to enable. We have a cool, there's a variety of ways you can enable it. So if you want to, you can write your own custom build server, your own custom continuous integration server. And on every check-in, just automatically kick off a build and automatically deploy it into the cloud. And I showed you earlier how you can use PowerShell in order to script things out. You also saw through the portal how you can just manually do it. What we enable also is something we call Visual Studio Online, which allows you to hook up, if you're a Visual Studio user, your Visual Studio IDE or your set of team environments, and you can automate this in a really nice way using Visual Studio Online as well. And this lets you use either TFS or Git as your source control system. It enables you to leverage our built-in cloud-based build servers. So we'll spin up servers and automatically do compilations and builds for you in the cloud, so you don't have to manage that. And we have a complete continuous integration environment where you can run your unit tests and then automatically deploy in the cloud in one continuous motion, all built in. And so it ends up being a really powerful way and a really easy way that you can go ahead and enable a continuous integration environment. So let's take a look at how this works and how you can leverage it. So we're going to go back into Azure and see how many users are on our system now. Did we break 2,000? No, oh, we're only at 1,700 still. We come back again, and I bet we'll be at 2,000 in not too distant future. So what I'm going to do here is actually show how you could build and manage a very simple DevOps workflow using Visual Studio Online, Visual Studio, and Windows Azure. And to start off with, I'm going to go into Visual Studio, and I can just create a new project. And so you can create any number of projects inside Visual Studio Online. And I just happen to have one that's already created that has a Hello World already deployed in it. So I'm just going to click on it. And so you can see it gives me a view on, you know, my sprint, my current sprint, my bug items, my work items, what my burn down rate is, my Kanban board, etc. And I can go ahead and set up source control. In this case here, I've set up Git-based source control within this system. And you can see here, I just have a simple MVC project that's already loaded up within it. You can see here, I've got Hello Leap Norway again. This was actually a talk I gave a couple weeks ago, so that was the last time I gave this talk. So we're going to change that source code for this event instead. But you can see this, I have source code already loaded up inside this project. Now, we're going to modify that source code in just a second, but before we do that, let's go into Azure and let's create a new website and let's link it to the source control repository. And so to do that, I'm just going to say custom create inside the Azure portal. And we'll just call this Scott Gu DevOps. And I'm going to, let's put it in, say, East US, or let's just put it in the West US. I'm going to publish it from source control. And you can see here, I can choose to link this to a variety of different source control repositories. I can use VS Online. I could use like a local Git repository. I could use GitHub. And I can enable the same DevOps workflow with GitHub if I wanted to. We even let you link it to Bitbucket if you want to use things like alternative source control providers that are out there. I could use CodePlex, external repository. I can even use Dropbox. Bitbucket enables me to do Mercurial, GitHub, TFS Online lets me use Git, Dropbox lets me use just Dropbox. So a lot of different ways I can link this flow. In this case here, we'll use Git using Visual Studio Online. I'm going to link it to my Visual Studio Online account. I'm going to use this little Authorize Now button in order to give Azure access to my Visual Studio Online repository. And then you can see here I got this sort of simple automated Hello World project. We're just going to go ahead and link this website to. And so you'll see here the Scott Gu DevOps website is being created. And in just a few seconds, it should be done. So hopefully, there we go. So that's Scott Gu DevOps. Don't go clicking it because there's nothing in it yet. Basically, I've got the Scott Gu DevOps site set up. And if you click the Deployment tab, one of the things when you set up a project with this kind of source control linkage is you'll see that there's a new Deployments tab that'll show up in the browser. And what this lets you do is it'll go ahead here and let you see what the status is of your Visual Studio Online builds. And so you can see I'm linked to a Visual Studio Online project. Right now, there's no deployments in here. That's because we haven't actually deployed anything into our Visual Studio code repository. Let's change that. So we'll go into Visual Studio. I'm going to go ahead and open up this automated Hello World project. You can see inside here it says Hello Leap Norway again. Let's actually say Hello Microsoft Learning. Instead, so we made a change. I've enabled Git on this project, and I'm using the built-in Git source control tools that are now part of Visual Studio. And you'll notice inside my Server Explorer, it's basically marked this file as changed. So there's a pending edit. Just go ahead and hit right-click edit, and I'm going to right-click, and I'll hit the commit tab or commit button. And it'll launch me into the Team Explorer window. I'm just going to say changed text. Commit this locally. So I've just committed this change to my local system. I'm now going to go ahead and sync this up to my Visual Studio Online project. So I just go ahead and hit sync. This will merge the changes I have in my local box with the ones that are in the hosted online. If I go back into Visual Studio Online here and just hit refresh on this particular file. Refresh, you'll see Hello Microsoft Learning is now the source code that is live in that VS Online project up in the cloud. And if I click on the Build tab here, one of the things you'll notice is I have the Scott Gu DevOps CD build definition that's been created for me. This was automatically set up for me when I went ahead and linked my website to that online repository. And alternatively, if I wanted to, I could go inside Visual Studio and there's a build definitions tab that I can go ahead and connect to. And so if I wanted to, I could go ahead and actually edit the build definition and customize it as well. So I could choose, what branch I'm using. You'll notice here the default setting we set is what's called continuous integration. This basically means every time we do a check-in, it's going to automatically kick off a build in Visual Studio Online. And if you click on the queued build right now, you can see we're doing a build right now. And once this build completes, it'll actually run through all the unit tests, and then it will actually go ahead and deploy that project into my Scott Gu DevOps website. And so this build is building and running. It'll probably take another minute or so in order to complete. And once it does, then it's going to go ahead and deploy it automatically into that Scott Gu website, and I'm good to go and I can start using it. In this case here, I'm deploying it live into the SkyQ website. We could use that staging feature I talked about a few minutes ago to instead deploy it into the staging site. I could do a last minute check on it, making sure that the build looks good, and then push the swap button and flip that staging site into live into production, at which point I have a completely automated workflow for check-ins to do builds and unit tests and to deploy into staging on Azure. And I can then either automate it or I can just do a one, have a manual person just put the swap button, so I always have some human before we go into live that does just as the last minute validation. And at that point, I can now be deploying this website literally dozens of times a day, all in a continuous way, all with guaranteed consistency across builds and across tests, so that every single time I do my deployment, my builds and my tests, I know that I'm always doing it the exact same way, and I have much more confidence in doing it lots and lots of times throughout the day. And as you saw here, that's pretty much how easy it is in order to actually queue it up. Looks like our build just completed. And if we go back here now inside here, and let's just go back here and click deployment. You'll see, there we go, our website actually deployed. It's live, and if you click the About button, it says, Hello, Microsoft Learning. And so literally, that was how easy it was in order to set up this website using a free Azure account. So it looks like a lot of people are hitting it right now, so you might actually run into at some point that I've exhausted my free quota. But I set up that website. I linked it to my Visual Studio Online Git account. I went ahead, made a change in Visual Studio, pushed it to my Git account. It did a build. It automatically deployed it. And that deployment is now live in production. If I did another deploy, it would start, they would each show up here, and you can actually click on them and hit redeploy in order to actually redeploy back into that site. So I can roll back and I can roll forward. And if I enable that staging feature, I can go ahead and have the staging feature be where my builds are automatically deployed to. I could test it out using a staging URL and then just hit the swap button in order to actually switch it back live into production. All automated. Literally, as you saw here, just took less than a minute to wire up end-to-end, and now I'm in business, and any number of people across my team now can basically be working on this site kind of enabling it in a really easy way. Other things in terms of cool features I could take advantage of, I mentioned this DevOps flow. You want to get this nice cycle where you're developing, deploying, operating, and learning. One of the things I always say about learning is, running a live service or running a live system is a little bit like the game of Frogger, in that if you've got good, and if you've ever played Frogger, you're going to have to get this little frog from the near end to the far end of the game without something hitting you. And there's lots of things hitting you from left, right, and center. Unexpected spikes in traffic, some bad code that accidentally got checked into production, etc. If you get good diagnostics, though, at least you know what's happening and you can figure out how to hop from around to around. Without good diagnostics, it's sort of like playing Frogger in the dark, and it ends up being really, really hard. And I think for most applications that people build, whether they're on-premise systems or they're ones hosted in a hosting account, one of the trickiest things is often figuring out and getting insights into what's really happening in the system so that when something goes wrong, you can immediately figure out what the problem is and diagnose it in a really easy way. And one of the things that's nice about Azure is we basically not only let you develop, operate, and deploy apps into production, but we also have really good logging and telemetry features that make it really easy for you to go ahead and actually understand what's happening in production after you actually went ahead and deployed it. And I'm just going to walk you through just a handful of features since we're running out of time that you can use in order to do that. So let's go back to the SkyQ DevOps website that we just deployed. One nice feature you can do if you click on the Configure tab is scroll down here. And we have a couple nice features here in the application diagnostic settings and in the site diagnostic settings that you can take advantage of in order to learn more about what your site is doing and how it's actually operating. So for example, let's say I want to enable my HTTP logs in order to actually be stored. And one of the things I can do here is I can just go ahead and create a new storage account in order to save my logs. And so I can just call this my SkyQ DevOps demo. And I'll just create a new little container here. And I can go ahead and hit save. And what this has gone ahead and done is it has basically just created for me inside my Azure subscription. And you know what? I just realized let me configure that on a different site that's in the East US region. And I'm going to do that only because otherwise I'm going to have to enter my password and I don't want to show it in front of all thousands of people. So I'm going to enable it on the site we created earlier here. So I'm just going to go ahead and enable this storage thing here, click manage. And I have a SkyGoo logs already created here. So I'm just going to create a new container and we'll call this SkyGoo logs demo. Hit OK here. We'll hit save. And what this is going ahead and doing is it is basically gone ahead and it is going to create for me a new log container account. You can see there is my SkyGoo logs demo container inside this little storage tool that's right here. And if I now go ahead and browse this site a few times and hit different pages around it, I'm generating activity on this site. If I come back inside here and hit refresh, occasionally takes about a minute or so for this the logs to show up. But what I'll see, oh, there we go, I just created it, is I can drill into this container, double click, and I can now, I'm seeing the HTTP logs automatically be uploaded. And you can see, there's another one. And looks like a few other people had that idea while I was doing the demo. And you can see I now have all the HTTP logs from this live website being populated inside that storage account into this text file. And so it's basically a really easy way. I can now go ahead and see what's happening in terms of traffic on my site, who's getting failures, who's getting errors, et cetera. And that was literally how easy it was for me to just go into the website, go ahead and click and say, store these web server logs to the storage account. And I'm just using the storage tool in order to access it. And you'll notice here in the tree view, it is 2014, the calendar year. That's the month, January, the day, the 27th. And that's the 17th hour of the day. And this is basically set to Greenwich Mean Time, which is why you might be wondering why it's 17 hours. This is presumably it's an 8-hour time difference to London, and so that's where that time comes from. And basically, you can see it's constantly being updated. I have different logs for different front-end VMs. Remember, we had two VMs running because we had autoscale turned on. So I can see exactly what's happening and whether or not those requests are succeeding or failing, how long they took. And who's accessing them all directly. So these are all 200s, good. If there was a 304, that's a redirect. We can look into that. If I saw 500s, I could then debug and try to figure out what the problem is. That's how easy it is to enable HTTP logs. If I wanted to, I could go ahead now and enable application logging as well. All I need to do is just turn this on. Again, I could go ahead and pick it to go to that same blob storage account. This allows me to take my system diagnostics, so the same logs inside .NET that I'd use with system diagnostics in order to do trace statements, I can pump errors, warnings, information, or verbose, and store it in that blog, SkyGoo demo logs account. And so I could basically just go ahead and dump all of my system diagnostic settings into that account. And now if I instrument my app with system diagnostic lines, all those trace statements will also be written into the storage account for me automatically. And this will be collected across a web farm of machines. And just like you saw with the HTTP logs, it'll be time-based, which makes it really, really easy for me if someone starts saying, hey, I'm seeing errors on the site. I can immediately look at my logs, both my HTTP logs, as well as my system diagnostic logs, and correlate and try to figure out what's causing those errors. And what might be going wrong within the system. Other cool features that we enable, again, I could do outside-in monitoring, so I could set it up so that we could basically say, if we scroll up here, homepage is up, say MSL demo, and I could basically say, hey, let's hit this site from San Antonio and from Chicago, and actually I just type in the URL there, and then once I hit save, we'll constantly be pinging this site from multiple locations. And I can set up what's called an alert. I just need the time. Let me just show you an existing one that already exists. If I go back here on top of, say, my ScottGoo website, which is an existing log that I already have, I can go ahead and on my monitoring tab here, I can look at alerts and metrics that I've set up, or I can create a new one automatically set. So you can see the metric details here. And so this is constantly hitting my site from outside locations. You can see the average millisecond response time for that site. I can set up a rule. So if I wanted to, I could say automatically anytime, for example, let me actually look at a rule that I already have defined here. I can set up a rule so that anytime my site or my click here, and you can see this rule. I basically set it up so that anytime this site basically goes above 5 seconds, it automatically sends me an email. You notice it hasn't fired in the last 7 days, which I guess is good. You see, 7 days ago, this is good that it hasn't fired because it basically means Azure is working well. But if, for example, I had a code bug where maybe I was hanging on a database connection or on a resource that wasn't there and my latency spiked in my website, this rule would trigger and automatically send me an email or anyone else that I define the rule to go to saying, hey, by the way, this website seems to be having problems. All automatically, I could then log in, look at my logs, and very quickly figure out what the problem might be. Again, the cool thing is all these features are just built in. You can take advantage of all of them in a really easy way within your site and stuff you can leverage. Right now, I'm storing all this diagnostic and all this log data into a service called their storage service, which is a built-in capability of Windows Azure. This is a highly scalable, durable storage system in the cloud. What's great about this is I can store literally petabytes of data inside our storage system. And so we've got some customers that store hundreds of petabytes. Most people store a lot less, but you can go up to hundreds of petabytes if you want to. And you can basically write to the storage system using our .NET, PHP, Node.js, Java, Python, Ruby APIs, or you can just write to it using a REST API. You can keep your storage system content secure so that only you can access them, or you can also optionally expose the contents of the storage system over HTTP. And so this is a really nice way. Let's say, for example, you have a website where you upload documents, maybe a PDF file or images. Rather than always have to access them and stream them through a web server or a website, you can go ahead and upload them into the storage account, mark that file as public, and then you can get back a URL that you can then give out to people, and they can access those files directly off of the storage system. And you can do it either publicly, or you can lock it down to make it more secure. All that's a nice, really built-in feature of our storage system. Other cool feature we have is something called import-export capability. This is a new feature we have now with Azure. It's basically, if you ever want to import or export a lot of data into the storage environment, you can basically create a storage account using the portal. Just create a new storage account, quickly create it where you want to go. And for example, this ScottGoo logs storage account was where I was storing those HTTP logs. And you can monitor it, manage it, and set up alerts for it, just like you could a website. This import-export feature then is kind of cool. And basically what it lets you do is if you want to import a lot of data or you want to export a lot of data, it allows you to actually send us a hard drive of that data. And you can use this wizard, and you basically just FedEx us, and we give you a special code. And you can FedEx the drive to us, and then we'll just plug it in and copy the data directly into your storage account. So if you've got terabytes or terabytes or petabytes of data that you want to ingest, this provides a really nice way that you can go ahead and through a hard drive without having to go over the internet, stick it on, encrypt it, send it to us in the mail, and 2 days later, we can go ahead and have it live for you up there on the site. So if you're in a place where you have low connectivity or you don't want to saturate your network, or you don't want to spend days uploading stuff, this is a really easy, really inexpensive way. I think it's $40 per drive. So you can put 4 terabytes on this drive and send it to us. And for $40, you'll have all that content uploaded and ready in the site. No additional charge, no bandwidth charges apply. Likewise, you can remove any amount of data from the site as from your storage account as well. So again, if you want to do a lot of processing of data, or you want to store a lot of data, it's really easy for you to import and export it directly from our system. We also have more features. I'm sort of running out of time, so I'm not going to be able to go into too many more. But for example, if you want to use Active Directory in the cloud, we have a nice Active Directory service that we run as a managed service. So you can create an Active Directory instance, just like you saw me do with a website or with a storage account or with a database. Literally takes about 10 seconds, and you have Active Directory stood up in the cloud. What's great is you can integrate it with an on-premise directory. So that means that, you know, in the same way that your machines can connect to an on-premise environment today, you can set it up so that you connect your directory server in the cloud to your on-premise environment so that your users show up in both locations and people can basically single sign on in the cloud or on-premises using the same Active Directory accounts they already have. And this makes it really easy for your users, your corporate users, to actually access applications in the cloud using their corporate credentials. So it enables you to use the same security environment you already use for on-premises apps and instead run them in the cloud. You can also use them to basically connect on to, say, Salesforce.com or Concur, or Workday, or Office 365, or any other third-party SaaS solution using that same environment as well. And what's nice is setting up the sync relationship is really easy. You basically just run a simple tool on your Active Directory account, and you basically can just cycle through this. So do it once, and at that point, your Active Directory in the cloud is synced with your Active Directory in Azure, and basically your users can basically sync back and forth in a really simple, clean way, and it's really easy to enable. Once you do that, you can also, within ASP.NET, just go ahead and create new web applications, publish them using websites like we showed just a minute ago, what you can enable when you create that app is just click this new change authentication option inside Visual Studio, point it to your Active Directory running inside Azure, at which point you can do single sign-on with this website without you having to domain join that website, without it having to be part of your corporate intranet, but you now have the same corporate security credentials that you can use for accessing an on-premise server. Your users can now log into that website with autoscale, with the staging and production, with all of that DevOps workflow stuff that I showed. You can now have as secure an application as you would on your intranet, taking advantage and running inside the cloud. So I know we're over time, but just want to close by I'm going to close in just a minute. I've only shown you, scratched the surface of what you can do with Azure. I've shown only virtual machines, and I think we talked about SQL databases and websites and Active Directory. There's a whole bunch more capabilities that you can leverage inside Azure. This slide talks about just some of the services you can use. They're all pretty much as easy as the ones that I showed here. If you want to build a mobile backend for an iOS or a Windows 8 or Windows Phone or Android client, we've got a great mobile services backend that lets you do that. If you want to do push notifications so that you can broadcast push events to mobile devices, we've got a great service for that. If you want to encode video and stream it in the cloud, we've got a great service for that. We've got BizTalk services if you want to do B2B or EAI interactions in the cloud. We've got a Hadoop cluster service, so if you want to ingest lots of data, maybe over hard drives or generate those log files, and then spin up MapReduce clusters in order to process them, it's really easy to spin up Hadoop inside our cloud, and a whole bunch more. And every month and every 2 to 3 weeks, we launch a new service which provides more capabilities that you can leverage and take advantage of, and you're going to see us continually with Azure ship these types of new services that you can go ahead and leverage and use. And hopefully you've seen, you know, in this last hour and a half, how easy it is to get started with Azure. It enables you to move really fast, save a lot of money, and take advantage of this consistency, and hopefully build some really cool stuff. To learn more about Azure, you know, definitely watch the other sessions we're having here this week. You can also check out friday.azure.com. This is a weekly series with Scott Hanselman, where we show a nice, quick 10-minute video that kind of has him going through, walking through what you can do with Azure and kind of explaining some of the background contents around it. And then also go to our Windows Azure website, sign up for free. Every demo I've shown here today, you can do yourself. And if you're an MSDN customer, use that same Microsoft ID that you use with your MSDN account, and you get free credits that you can leverage as well. And I think you'll hopefully find cloud's really fun. You can do some really great stuff with it, and it makes development better than ever. And hope you give it a try, and hope you enjoy it. Thanks so much.